Hello and welcome to BusyWorks Beats. .com. Smash that like button so you could add more air to my lungs. I'm officially 29, so shout out to everybody who wished me well. And thank you for the birthday wishes. I turned 29 April 7th, so it's a couple days back. But I just want to thank you and smash that like button so we can help more producers around the world. I'm Game from BusyWorksBeats.com. If you're new here, we've trained over 600,000 producers around the world. And today I want to show you how to get your microphone recordings a lot cleaner. So this microphone sounds the way it sounds because I'm a low voice person. So this mic works really well for me. This is called a Shure SM7B microphone. It's actually cheap for the quality. It's very cheap. It's like $400, but the quality is very high. Because my mentor recorded this and a Neumann U87, which is behind me. This is a more expensive mic, the Neumann U87. Very expensive, actually. Not a beginner mic. Anyway, he recorded me with both those, and I actually like my voice on the Shure SM7B more than the Neumann at the time. So that's why I got it. Anyway, the one thing you need for your Neumann is called a cloud lifter. So here's, hopefully you can see that. Let me see, where am I at with it? Cloud lifter, okay. And this is going to basically boost the volume of the microphone, because when you start using it, it will be really low volume and it needs, you know, amplification, okay. So that's why I have the cloud lifter. So it's the Shure SM7B going to a cloud lifter into my universal audio interface, where I'm just boosting the levels a little bit more using their preamps. Do you need to know all that to make your microphone sound good? No. So we're going to get into the tactics today. I'm even going to show you in FL Studio. You can apply this to any DAW, any scenario, any video editing program. It's the same process. It comes down to mainly four different things, which is a noise gate to get rid of the background noise, and a corrective EQ, which means taking out the resonance you don't want, compression, and then a color EQ, or something that kind of shapes the sound a little bit. So that's really what it comes down to. And I'll show you a couple bonus things just so you can have more in your palette. So let's begin. Again, smash that like button so we can help more producers and artists around the world, even people in the video editing industry. I didn't realize how much audio editing they do. So we're in FL Studio. Let's just slide over to FL. I'm going to show you my chain, but I don't want you to overly obsess about my chain because it changes all the time. Okay, so the first thing I use is a de-esser because BusyWorks Beats. So when you see that blue, it's pulling down the frequencies that are very sharp when you say S. Okay, so that's all it does. It really just makes it less sharp. Okay, less sharp. And that's what the de-esser does. I have mine set to negative 20 dB minimum, and my voice has the S around 6.5 kilohertz. You don't need to memorize that. That's kind of optional. It depends on a lot of other things. But here's what it comes down to. Here's the one thing you really want to learn is called a channel strip. So a channel strip is basically a lot of plugins in one. It's modeled after like an actual console, they're called. It would have like this long strip, and it would have different things on it, like an EQ, and then it would have a compressor section, then it would have a dynamics section, then it would have, EQ, then it would have filter and panning. It would all be this long thing on a console. So they kind of condensed it for you into a plugin form. You don't need this specific plugin. There's a lot of channel strip plugins out there, and some come with the DAW, some don't. So it depends on your DAW. First thing I'm going to do is just boost the level with the line input. Just turn the levels up so that your mic's not super quiet. Because if you have your mic super quiet, you're not really going to capture the essence. And so the sweet spot, now for videos, my mic's really loud because I don't want to have to compress my vocal live. I want it just to be loud. But if you're recording for an artist, you actually want to pull this down to about negative 12 to negative 6 dB. That's a decent range. And you can measure it with your meters in your DAW. Usually channel strips come with a meter here. So you can see negative 6, negative 12. I'm right in that sweet spot. Now, for you, you want to just check your DAW to triple check. So let's pull the line down. Okay. And I'm just going to keep talking until I'm in that sweet spot of about negative 12 to negative 6. And I want to get loud. I want to get quiet because I want to test the range of my vocal, and I want it to average around negative 12 to negative 6. That's just a decent spot. The reason we record this low for artists is because we want to capture what's called dynamic, and we also want to be able to have what's called headroom. Let me turn my levels back up. We want headroom so that we can add effects. So for example, if actually I'll do it towards the end, if I remember. I'll show you the difference between leaving headroom and leaving no headroom. Okay, so this is my mic all the way up. So just turn it up until it sounds crispy. Boom. Okay, now this is a different knob. I'm not using this because of how the plugin's set up. Okay, skip all this other stuff. Next thing you're going to need, if you're recording vocals, chances are you're going to need a filter, okay, for your artist or for your actor, whomever it may be. So I turn this off because I want to have a lot of control over the full frequency spectrum, but if you want to record with it on, you can. I would suggest the filter until you start to hear your voice kind of hollow out. Now you can hear now my vocals have is like zero bass, okay? My voice is, okay. Another thing you need to understand about vocals is the person actually singing or performing, because my voice is literally the lowest octave. And there's an app called, I think, let me find the app, hold up. This app will help you understand your vocal range. It's called, hurry up, it's called the Vanido, V-A-N-I-D-O, Vanido. And it has like a whale symbol on it, okay? And Vanido will show you your singing range. This is important because if my whole vocal range is way down at the low end, that means the core of my voice is at the low end. So I can't always cut the core of my voice or else I won't have my voice. So me cutting everything below 200 hertz is actually cutting my actual voice. So it's a balance type of thing. Like if I want to hear myself like this the whole time, I'm not going to have the full richness of my voice. But if I cut just below 100 hertz and just cut the sub frequencies from 80 and below, then I'll keep my natural low end voice, but I'll cut out the rumbles and like me shaking the mic and, you know, me tapping the desk or whatever, little booms in there. Now, booms are not preventable with an EQ, okay? So I don't want to like put falsities into your brain. But anyway, a high pass filter is good to just cut out that low end. Just keep it simple. I like to cut, for a low male, you're going to cut 80 and below. For a higher voice, you'd probably cut somewhere between 150 and below. Okay, now you have to sweep around to find your sweet spot. Next thing you want on your vocal is an EQ. Now this channel strip is not the easiest to understand corrective EQ. So let's pull up Isotope's EQ. And the reason I'm doing this is to show you the frequency spectrum. In my opinion, it's easier to use a spectral EQ to correct because you can actually see what's going on. And that's important because sometimes you can't always, like, your ear hears something, but you don't know exactly where it is, especially the high frequencies. So without giving you a college education about resonance, if you notice these little humps at the bottom, they're very clear. Like, I have about, so when I say, I want you to look at these little humps in the graph. As I have no auto-tune. Okay. So these are called resonances and they're based on what's called a fundamental frequency. So I know we're getting a little physics-y talking, but I want you to understand what it is so that you can have the power. What am I doing? So you can have the power to adjust it. Give me a second to get my life together here. Let's open this back up. Okay. So what you want to do is your mic can be overly resonant, meaning that these frequencies that are your natural, what it's called a fundamental frequency, that lowest bump, that lowest bump, what these other bumps are just duplicates or multiples of that lowest bump. So, let's say my lowest bump is 100 hertz. The next bump will come at 200 hertz because it's called the second harmonic. You don't need to memorize all this. You just need to know where it comes from so that you can address it. So, so my other harmonics right at 200. Okay. That's math. So we have 100 as my fundamental frequency, 200 as my second harmonic, and then it's times 300, then times 400 times 500 and on and on and on. Those are called harmonics. So sometimes your microphone can overly embellish those frequencies and make them super intense. So your goal is to correct those resonances and pull them down in volume. So you can use a dynamic EQ just so you don't do like a harsh cut. I would probably prefer a dynamic EQ for people who are more advanced, but you can use a regular EQ if that's all you have. I forgot the note I was singing. So all I'm going to do is just pull this down so that it controls that low frequency. you don't have to be so extreme. I'm just showing you this so you can hear. So now that you have those frequencies cut out, it's a lot easier for the ear to feel balance when they hear your voice. Now that's only when you sing one note. Now notice as I talk, as I do different notes, the humps move around. So the question is, okay, we're cutting here, but the hump moves. And that's where we get really technical as to EQ technique and all these things. I don't want to confuse you to death, but that's what resonance means, and that's what resonance is, usually around your fundamental frequencies. So let's pull this back up. Now, another resonance that can happen is the resonance of your room. So your room is actually creating a frequency, and you can't necessarily hear it all the time. So what you can do, let's pull up another point, and your mic could be adding a resonance. One time I had a mic that was just like faulty, and it had a really sharp high frequency. It was like beyond audible S. It was like just a little bit higher. So let's say, for example, here's what a resonance would sound like. I probably can't even exaggerate it to the point where it was before, but it had a really high frequency, somewhere around like 14,000 hertz. And I had to use a really narrow, it's called a narrow band. Okay, that's why I use an EQ like this, parametric EQ, to get those narrow bands. And then I had to cut that frequency. Now, this is rare that you'll have those type of frequencies, but in that case, you would cut really deeply at one specific frequency if you do have that like ringing sound in your microphone. But rarely does that happen. So I wouldn't highly recommend you do that unless you know for sure that it's like a set ringing sound in your microphone. And again, I've had different microphones, so everybody's different. So let's get into another portion of the, so again, as a recap, we have cleaning up the signal. So we're not done about cleaning up the signal. We have corrective EQ. Next thing you want to try is noise. Let's open up the FL version. It's called Fruity Limiter. Where's it at? And what this will help you do is get rid of all the background noise. So by nature, your mic may be like, I understand, I used to have a mic like that. So what you want to do is use a noise gate in FL Studio specifically. You want to turn the gain down and then turn your threshold up. What this means is that it will cut out all the volume below a certain point. So if I turn this all the way up, you won't hear my whole voice. You're going to hear like my voice separate because it's not going above the threshold. But if I lower it, then you hear my whole voice. But so as I pull this up, it's cutting everything below a certain volume. So you won't hear the background noise because your background noise will be like a resting level and then your voice will be up here. So if you just cut the resting level, you'll be able to hear your voice. So this is good for like very subtle background noise. Now you got to be careful with noise gates because sometimes you'll cut off the ends of your words like S's or like the tails of a word. So in that case, you want to make your release tail pretty big. I like my release tail around 150 milliseconds. You can make it longer if you want, but let me show you what that would sound like. Check, 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 check. So for this one, I would just subtly move that threshold up and, you know, just keep looking at the graph to see if you're getting rid of that little background noise. Because sometimes you'll have a computer fan that's really loud. So you gotta, with those, you gotta finesse them a little bit. Okay, it's not gonna be the easiest setting, but at least you know how to do it. Next, let's open up let's pull the EQ back. So let's say I'm recording for myself and I rarely use an EQ, a corrective EQ going in because my mic doesn't really have stuff to correct. But for you, you may need that for your microphone. So if you're more advanced like me, I like the dynamic EQ on Isotope a lot better. It doesn't overly take out volume, okay? So that's why I use it. And I can visually see what's going on. So I'll do something like this. Remember those low frequencies that are very resonant in my voice? I'll do something like this. And that just controls the low end a little bit. You can still hear the low end, but it just makes it tame, okay? And then we're running into the channel strip. Again, cutting out those low frequencies that we don't need, like 80 and below for my voice. I have a noise gate. This is what this section is. This is a little more convoluted. That's why I showed you the FL Studio version of it. But this is essentially a noise gate. And then we have the, what else? The de-esser, don't forget. I have the microphone being turned up. excuse me, and now let's add the colorful EQ. So this EQ is just to boost the frequencies that sound good with your voice. I'm going to boost 8K. It makes you really crystal clear, but you got to be careful with that not to overly do it. You can also boost 12K. It depends on if you're talking or singing. Again, my mic's set up to talk, not really to sing. So I'm going to boost 8K because we're talking and I want you to hear me clearly. 5K is another one of those like hear you clearly type of frequencies. So if I turn this up, you're going to hear me nice and crystal clear. But you really have to be careful with that frequency as well because it can get very sharp. Next is kind of like the mid-range. I don't really mess with this for my voice because I don't need any coloration there. And then I boost 200 hertz just to kind of round out my voice. That's my setup. But you wouldn't be, it depends on the song. That's why I said don't obsess about the EQ settings and all this, because if you're not a low male singer, you're not going to have these same settings. If you're not a high, if you're a high female singer, why would you boost 200 hertz for the low end unless you needed to round out your vocal? So I don't want you to obsess about this stuff. I just want to show you how to clean up your signal so that you can get a better vocal take. Now here's the more advanced stuff we'll get into, is how to spice it up as you're recording. So let's act as if I'm recording some type of song or something. Let's make my voice a little less bassy. Let's cut out some lows. I really don't need 200 hertz. And let's boost maybe 12K for my voice to add the little, it's like a crispy shimmer. I don't know how else to say it, but it's a crispy shimmer at 12K, 10K, 12K. And let's boost somewhere around, I like 5K, that was a good spot. Okay, and now I have more of a clear vocal, okay. Let's pull these down a little bit more. Because for me, when my low end, especially in trap music, really clashes with the bass and the 808. So I have to make sure that I'm cutting out those frequencies. And that's why I use that EQ. Okay, so now my voice sounds, now here's a before and after just to show you. Here's before. This is just raw, straight into the DAW. Sounds good, but it sounds kind of hollow. It sounds weird, actually. Let me turn my levels up. Check. It sounds good. It just, you can hear the room. Okay, now here's with the effects on it. I sound a lot more clean, crystal clear. It doesn't sound boxy and weird. So now let me show you again, make sure pre is on if you're in FL Studio. This means you're not recording hardcore through these. It means if I record, it won't like be hard boiled through all these things. I can always change them out later. So that's what I have this on pre for. Now to make your vocal sound cooler as you're recording, again, the reason I'm showing you all this is because some singers, they want to hear their voice through the effects so that they get like amped up. They're like, oh my gosh, my voice is in reverb right now. And they start doing weird stuff when they hear their vocals through the effects. Same way you play guitar a little bit different when you hear it through a chorus or a reverb or a delay. That's how artists think. So let's create some space. So here's another plugin you probably want to add to your arsenal. It's called Auto-Tune. I have it on low latency mode. This is important when you're recording because some people get thrown off by delay when they're recording. Most people, not some people. And let's pick a random scale. Let's do C minor. And since I don't know the notes, I'm going to oddly sing at zero retune speed. Okay, I had to know what the scale was. And let's set the retune. And now again, retune speed changes per the genre. But if you want auto-tune on without it being apparent, in the new auto-tune, they let you have this thing called correction style. I keep mine around like 30 as a safe spot. You could turn it up or down. I like to keep mine between 30 and 50. And my retune speed between 10 and 20. So this way you can barely tell it's on, but it's on. And auto-tune is a sound. It's not that people can't sing, it's a sound to it. If you're more familiar with music production, it's like legato for your voice. And it just does stuff that your voice can't really do naturally, but that's the point of it. It's not because people can't sing. Okay, let's delete the other plugins. So again, as a recap, I have a de-esser as my first step. A dynamic EQ. Usually I don't do this going in, but I just wanted to show you how to correct the vocal sound and give you the best presentation for it. Then we have a channel strip. I'm cutting out the lows. I did my coloration EQ. I did the noise cutting of the background. I didn't do a compressor because I'll do it now because I'm recording a vocal, but theoretically you don't really need a compressor. Let's not say it that way. Forget what I just said because that's not true. What I mean is, let's just do it. I don't want you to like say you have to do it or you don't have to do it. Let's just pull the level down first. So let's check. Now, compressor, if you're recording like in a pro studio, the compressor going in is really just to make sure you don't have clipping. But if you're not clipping and you're not worried about it, you don't really need to obsess about a compressor going in. But as far as mixing, yeah, compressor would be good. So first thing I'm going to do is turn my level back down. So I'm between negative 12 and negative 6. So check. And again, test different volumes. Check. I forgot the scale. Check. I'm still sitting at like negative 15. Check. I'm still somewhere below negative 15, but when I talk, then I'm in that negative 12 to negative 6. Maybe I'm just singing at a low volume. So it's somewhere between there. Okay. The point is you don't want your thing to go up in the red or even the yellow. So you really want to tame it early because then you're going to leave room for all the other effects. So I know that's kind of convoluted, but again, I haven't really sung anything. So there's nothing to, let me pull up a guitar so we can kind of demonstrate this because it's not. Oh, did I move my packs? I might have moved my packs. Who is a loop I can use? Let's go to who has loops? Jonathan has loops. Is he in here? You know what? All my stuff is in the other folder, and I changed my drives, so I would have to go find it. That's why I'm like on the spot right now for a loop. Produced by Jack. Okay, his loops. Let's use one of his loops. Okay, now I'm gonna set the key in auto-tune. We just have to find the notes. Now, when you're in the studio, you're gonna have to use like a piano app on your phone or something where you can play the notes to know which notes to put into auto-tune. I can't go into tuning. It's a much deeper science. You have to understand tuning. Just like you can't pick up a guitar and just start playing, you have to tune it first. So that goes beyond the key and beyond the scale. You have to tune it first. So that's the first step is tuning. Is it at 440 hertz? Is it at 440 hertz? Is it at 440 hertz? Is it at 445 hertz? Is it at 432? You have to know what the tuning is and then you find the key. So a lot of people skip the tuning part and they're so confused. So here are the notes we can use. So now what I do is I open up AutoTune. And again, if you were in the studio doing that, you wouldn't just pull up FL. If you're in Pro Tools, you would pull up an app on your phone or something to help you get those notes. So let's do C chromatic. I like to do it this way because I have a lot more control over the notes. So the notes we're using are, so I'm looking at the notes we're not using. We're not using D sharp. We are not using F sharp. We're not using G sharp. We are not using B. And we're not using C sharp. Okay, so now I'm in the key of this song. I just took out the notes that we're not using. Now I can sing over this loop and I'll be in key. So now I'm just gonna show you a bunch of effects you can add to make an artist feel like they sound cooler. And this will be the end of the video. So add any reverb you like. You don't need this reverb. Again, use any reverb that you like. There's no specific plugins. I'm just showing you what I like. And I'm going to set this to a warm hall preset. Put it on wet mode, so it's only the reverb. And I send, by clicking these arrows, I send the microphone to this reverb. So it's sending a duplicate to that spot. We teach this in our Mixing Academy. Again, I'm kind of giving you a very broad brush, but you can go to busyworksbeats.com/mixing academy to learn more about this. I'll leave a link below. Don't worry about it. Or busyworksbeats.com/mixing if you want training. Anyway, let's go here to the microphone. Let's pull up a doubler. Now you wouldn't use this all the time. This is more for making the vocal wide. This is probably something you would do after the fact. You wouldn't do it during, but some people like that sound of a doubler. It's very subtle. You can't even tell it's there. Then a fruity delay. Or any delay in this case. We're gonna use a high pass filter for my voice, ping pong mode. This is just the setting I like. And it locks into the tempo. So this is 132 BPM. Let's pull this down to 132. Let me make my auto-tune faster for this style of song. And then pull my flex tune down a little bit so it sounds a little more robotic on purpose.
Yeah. Pulling in his daddy, holla, yeah.
So I'm just going to lay a random melody, and this is just going to get you a lot. Let me turn this down a little bit. This is going to get you a lot hyper when you're doing your melodies, when you hear yourself through all these effects. And that would be my chain. Now, the only thing I didn't do is compress. So let me do that real quick. Fast attack for this type of vocal. Is it going to let us turn on the compressor? That would help. 2-to-1 ratio is pretty safe. Negative 20 dB is a safe spot in a fast release for a rap vocal. Again, it's different per the genre. Don't obsess about that. So let's record. So in FL Studio, you click on the track that is the mic, click the little red circle at the bottom, then record audio into playlist.
Yeah, dripping in my Caddy, like, yeah. Pulling a Ferrari, like, yeah. Drippin', 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 yeah. Drippin', 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 yeah, yeah. Drippin' in a Caddy, like, yeah. Pull up in Ferrari, like, yeah. Drippin', 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 yeah. Drippin', 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 yeah.
Okay, so now let's hear it back. Now when you hear it back, it's not gonna run through all those effects. So what I'm going to do is right click the microphone, go to File, Save Mixer Track State As, and drag that to an empty track, like track 10. Because since you recorded pre, here's what it sounds like without the plugins. Here's what it sounds like just raw with no plugins on.
Yeah, dripping in my Caddy, like, yeah. Pulling a Ferrari, like, yeah. Drippin', drippin', drippin'.
So what we have to do is rerun it through the plugins. That's what pre means. It records it through the plugin so you can hear it, but it doesn't hard boil it into the actual recording. So that way you have the ability to go back and change stuff. Okay, so let's turn this mic on. I mean, let's turn the effects on and let's turn these on, but turn off the creative stuff. And the one thing you have to do is send your mic back to the reverb.
Yeah. Drippin' in my Caddy, like, yeah. Pulling a Ferrari, like, yeah. Drippin', 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 yeah.
Forgot to turn the plugins on. There we go.
Yeah. Drippin' in my Caddy, like, yeah. Pulling a Ferrari, like, yeah. Drippin', 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 yeah. Drippin', 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 yeah. Yeah. Trippin' in a Caddy, like, yeah. Pull up in Ferrari, like, yeah. Drip it, drip it, drip it, yeah. Drip it, drip it, drip it, yeah.
Okay, so that is the magic of... Turn these back off. That's the magic of cleaning up the vocal. It just makes it sound way different. I'll do a quick A-B just to show you where we started and what it turned into. Again, you can learn a lot more in our Mixing Academy. Just go to busyworksbeats.com/mixingacademy. We have a ton of courses in there. There's a How to Mix Vocals Easily course showing you how to mix your vocals for the modern genres. We have a course in there, How to Mix Your Beats Easily. So how to actually mix your beats to loud enough to where you're leaving room for the artist. And lastly, the Mixing Academy, which is more advanced mixing of how to mix songs. Okay, so that's what's in there.
Yeah. Drippin' in my Caddy, like, yeah. Pulling a Ferrari, like, yeah. Drippin', 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 yeah. Drippin', 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 yeah, yeah. Drippin' in a Caddy, like, yeah. Pull up in Ferrari, like, yeah. Drippin', 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 yeah. Drippin', 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 yeah.
Now this is only the beginning. There's so many more things you can do. Again, just click that link below. Go to busyworksbeats.com/mixingacademy. We even offer free training to get you started to understand some of this stuff. Okay, so we're not speaking like a whole different language to you. Anyway, thank you for watching today. It's BusyWorksBeats.com.